So let's get into the space news this week. And if you're not following on X, we have an X account. It's at Space Startup Hub. So please follow us there. And let's get into the first article. And this is Axiom Space and KBR successfully complete first crewed thermal vacuum test of next generation spacesuit. And if you're not aware, NASA has chosen Axiom Space to produce the spacesuit that the astronauts will use on the moon. So starting with Artemis 3, the first crewed landing on the moon, they will be using the Axiom spacesuits. Originally, there were two contracts, one with Axiom Space, the second one with Collins Aerospace. Collins dropped out, so now Axiom is the only company working on a spacesuit for the moon. So they are a critical supplier for NASA, and the Artemis landings with crew cannot take place until this spacesuit has been qualified and passed critical design review. So let's look at the article. They've successfully completed the first uncrewed thermal vacuum test of the Axiom Extravehicular Mobility Unit, or AXEMU. This is a critical next step in collecting data on how the spacesuit will endure the harsh environment on the lunar south pole during the Artemis 3 mission. The suit's advanced protection will enable astronauts to work at the lunar south pole and in the moon's permanently shadowed regions for at least 2 hours. And they go on to say, first in a series of tests, which will grow in complexity and scope as Axiom Space moves towards the spacesuit qualification phase with NASA. And they have achieved over 700 hours of crewed pressurized time in the spacesuit. The Axiom EMU is currently in the critical design phase. And once it passes that phase, they can then start building the flight hardware. So increased flexibility, greater protection, and longer EVA time to expand exploration of the lunar surface. So that is the article. NASA cannot go to the moon unless his spacesuit is working correctly. This screenshot from the confidential report by Jared Eichmann. And I did this video early in the week. He does flag concerns about the Axiom suits. He says, Axiom suits, what is the clear state of the suit and schedule, and why are we getting mixed stories? Which is a bit concerning because, in public at least, everything's going fine. But if he's putting that in the confidential report, maybe behind the scenes, maybe there's problems, there's delays we don't know about. Hopefully those problems have been ironed out. That report was from May, so we're now in December, but it is a critical piece of technology. There's a video they posted on the X account, so we can see they're testing the spacesuit. They'll cycle the temperature from hot to cold to make sure that it can withstand the extreme temperatures at the lunar south pole. So that's the video. The temperatures at the lunar south pole, it varies depending on where you put your camp, but it's probably minus 50 degrees to plus 70 degrees, or it could be more extreme. And if you've not seen the video yet on the leaked report from Jared Eichmann on his plans for NASA, there's the video. And it talks about the Axiom spacesuit and the mixed stories he's receiving about it. Okay, moving on to our second story this week, and this is also highly relevant for NASA's plans for the moon and Mars. And this is the Series B funding round for Antares, which is building micro-nuclear reactors. They've announced $96 million funding in a Series B funding round. And this funding will help them design, build, and test nuclear reactors within a few years. This capital will be deployed towards hardware, subsystem testing, fuel fabrication, manufacturing, and the infrastructure required to turn on a reactor. In 2026, we will conduct a low-power reactor demonstration, the Mark Zero, at Idaho National Laboratory. And this Mark Zero will be to validate the reactor physics and the reactivity controls of our R1 design and establish the facility, tooling, and operations required for sustained and enduring testing. And in a section called What Comes Next, they talk about building a full-power electricity-producing reactor early as 2027, and this will be the first commercial prototype microreactor, the Mark 1. So the Mark 1 reactor will validate operating conditions at full power and temperature for at least 90 days. It will produce electricity for real-world applications, and it will validate the passive and inherently safe design characteristics and demonstrate startup, shutdown, and decommissioning. In a section on their market, they talk about NASA. They also talk about Space Force and Department of Defense. And they're going to say NASA's also announced its Fission Surface Power Program. That'll be for the lunar South Pole and the Moon. This program's requirements align with our manufacturing core competencies and design. We believe nuclear power is critical to enabling a space-based industrial economy. Their long-term vision is abundant energy throughout the solar system. We have the facilities, the fuel, and the team to execute one of the fastest and most consequential nuclear development timelines in modern history. So that's the article. So Jared Isaacman wants a big push towards nuclear power. So it's nuclear propulsion, and it's also nuclear surface power, or FSP, fission surface power. And that would be to power a moon base, also to power a Mars base, and propulsion for fast transit to Mars and further out into the outer planets. So if we look at the confidential report again, we can bring it up. We can see that in the section on nuclear power under key contacts and commercial interests, we have Antares Nuclear, and Jordan Bramble is the CEO. He's the guy who wrote the article we just read. So Jared knows about Antares Nuclear, and he considers it a key contact and commercial interest for NASA. That's very good news, because I think Jared wants to put billions of dollars into nuclear propulsion and nuclear technology by pivoting SLS funds into nuclear propulsion. So that's amazing news. Okay, on to our next story. Okay, this came across my radar. So let's have a look at this article. And the article is on AI startup builds moon dust battery for Blue Origin's lunar missions. So it goes on to say, Istari Digital, which I've not heard of, created an AI-designed moon vacuum that converts lunar dust into usable energy for Blue Origin. The battery solves lunar night power constraints, and it's designed entirely by an AI system, meeting all technical requirements. The moon vacuum that turns lunar dust into electricity. And we have a quote from the CEO of Istari. He says, so what it does is sucks up moon dust and it extracts the heat from it so it can be used as an energy source, like turning moon dust into a battery, unquote. NASA is pushing hard to return astronauts to the moon through the Artemis program. Most missions require massive solar arrays or nuclear reactors that add complexity and cost. So that's all we have. We don't really have a lot of details about it other than it sucks up dust to generate electricity. I looked on the Starry website and I can't find any information or details about it. So it's interesting, but without any technical details or videos of like it working, I don't know how real this is or how close it is to being a real product, but I found it interesting, so I included it. Okay, on to our next story, and this story is on iSpace, which is a Japanese lunar lander company. So this article is titled, iSpace Teams Up for Lunar Water Exploration. So it goes on to say, the next generation of companies heading to the moon are going in search of water. iSpace announced a partnership with Kurita Water Industries, a company that focuses on water extraction and treatment. And we have a quote here. It's from the CEO of iSpace, and he says, the search for and utilization of water resources on the lunar surface is essential to support the development of the cislunar economy that iSpace envisions, unquote. Under the partnership, the two companies will pursue three key areas of exploration. First is the business model for lunar water resource extraction. Second is payload development and validation. And the third is using iSpace landers for water demos on the lunar surface. And this is the second memorandum of understanding iSpace has signed with Kurita. And this article goes on to note that Elevation Space also signed an agreement with iSpace to conduct a mission to bring rocks back to Earth from the lunar surface. And it ends by noting that Japan is highly interested in resource extraction on the lunar surface and is working closely with iSpace to make that happen. So that was an interesting article, but I have another article. This is in Japanese, but I've machine translated it to English. So let's have a read of that article. This article is titled 7 years marked by private lunar exploration pioneer iSpace, learning from failure and moving towards commercialization. So it goes on to say that the Japanese space venture iSpace will end its 7-year private lunar exploration project or program, Kurita R. They had two missions to the moon that both failed. They failed on the landing part, so they managed to verify a lot of technologies, but they actually failed to land safely and softly. So it goes on to say the company developed the small lunar lander and the lunar rover. Two tries, two learnings. iSpace has positioned missions 1 and 2 so far as a research and development phase. Now, after completing the Hakuta R program, we are finally moving into the early commercialization phase. This is where the real battle begins. And under the section Accelerating Global Expansion, it says we're going to accelerate from here. Mission 3, led by a US corporation, is scheduled for 2027. This mission is selected for NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services, or CLPS, program, and it plans to land in the Schrodinger Basin near the Moon's South Pole. More on that later. So Mission 3 will use the newly developed Apex 1 lander, and it will land on the far side of the Moon and will also launch two communication relay satellites. This allows communication from the far side of the Moon, which is not directly visible from Earth. And in 2028, Mission 4, led by Japan, is scheduled to use the new Series 3 lander. In terms of the future for iSpace, the Moon is humanity's first stepping stone to economic activity in space and the first step towards the ambitious goal of creating an economic zone in the cislunar space between Earth and the Moon. iSpace aims to be a gateway for private companies to do business on the Moon. And it goes on to say, the era of private companies providing lunar transportation services, collecting data on the Moon, and conducting business is just around the corner. So that was an interesting article, and we actually have a graphic. It's in Japanese, but basically you can see 2027, they have a larger lander that's being developed in the US, and then 2028, you have the same large lander being developed in Japan, and then later on, you've got a full commercial lunar habitat and a cislunar economy. In terms of Mission 3, it's landing at the Schrodinger Basin. So if you look at this whole dotted area, so SBA is the South Pole area, and within that you have this circled area that's Schrodinger Crater. So we bring up this map, which has imagery of the whole of the Moon from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. We can actually zoom in and look at Schrodinger Basin. So you can see this little blue spot here, and we just zoom in. So in the center, you have the South Pole, so you have Shackleton Crater and so on. But we're zooming into this area here, and we can actually go in even further to this area called Schrodinger G. Get real close there. So you can see on the left, this raised area, which is some kind of volcano, but the black area is in permanent shadow. It's one of those permanently shadowed regions. So potentially there are lunar resources in this region that could be explored or exploited. So the Mission 3 lander, which is the larger lander for iSpace, will be in this area. I'm not sure whether the rover can reach Schrodinger G, but definitely scientists are looking at this area. Scientists are excited about this particular area, and potentially there's lunar resources such as lunar water ice that can be extracted. So that's Mission 3. And our final news story this week is on Badji Bhatt, who is the CEO of Aetherflux, and he's just posted about Galactic Brain. So he says, finally can share what we have been heads down on at Aetherflux USA, Galactic Brain, our orbital data center satellite, first node launch in Q1 2027. This is big. Why are we doing this? The biggest threat to developing artificial general intelligence isn't chips, it's energy. America's grid can't keep up. Data centers on Earth can take 5 to 8 years to build, and they are a massive drain on energy and resources. We need a better solution. So we're building one, Galactic Brain. Check it out here. So let's check out the article he wrote on Medium. Let's bring it up here. So he goes on to say, and this article is titled, Aetherflux announces orbital data center targets Q1 2027. Solar-powered artificial intelligence compute satellite bypasses 5 to 8 year terrestrial energy delays. So today, Aetherflux, it's actually yesterday, announced a Q1 2027 target for its first orbital data center satellite. He says there's a massive energy need for artificial intelligence. Access to energy is one of the primary bottlenecks for scaling artificial intelligence. This problem is driven by infrastructure timelines. Securing real estate, establishing utility connections, and constructing new data centers can take more than half a decade. And a quote from Badji Bhatt is, the race for artificial general intelligence is fundamentally a race for compute capacity and, by extension, energy. The elephant in the room is that our current energy plans simply won't get us there fast enough, unquote. Galactic Brain puts the sunlight next to the silicon and skips the power grid entirely, unquote. Aetherflux's first data center node for commercial use is targeted for Q1 2027. And then they will build a constellation of nodes to scale capacity. And this builds on the company's existing work developing space solar satellites for beaming power to contested environments. In 2026, the company plans to launch its first satellite to wirelessly transmit energy from low Earth orbit to Earth using lasers. So that's the article. This is the team at Aetherflux. The guy in the middle who's crossing his arms is the CEO, Badju Bhatt. So I've done a video on Aetherflux already, and that was on their original purpose, which was to collect solar energy in orbit and beam it down to Earth. And here's a few graphics from them. They've already received some money, some funding. We have this animation from the website. And basically, I think they're targeting the US military rather than remote outposts having to ship fuel, which is very expensive and also dangerous for the troops. You could just have orbiting satellites beam the energy directly to the military base. So one option is to beam down solar energy. Another solution is micro nuclear reactors, which is what Antares is working on, that can also power military bases. So that's the news this week. And as you can tell, there's a lot of news about orbiting data centers. All the big tech companies, Google and Microsoft and SpaceX, all seem to be focused now on orbiting data centers. And my next video will be on Elon Musk's vision, which is a very, very large vision for putting huge numbers of orbiting AI satellites in space and generating a huge amount of compute. And his plans don't stop in orbit. They go much further than that. So I'll cover that in my next video. But thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.